play. And if you can't play 80 to 82 games in the NBA, retire.
Oh, he was overused. You're dumb, too.
Our fault for thinking that the National Football League would get something right.
You don't complain because you are taking home a $17 million paycheck every year.
EB, I'm ready to rip my arm off, reach for the phone, and beat you with it. I'm going to tell little Bo Peep that she found her chief under his helmet.
I don't care if you're up 20 runs, 20 or one run. I don't care.
You focus on today, today, tomorrow, tomorrow. That's always been my attitude.
Good evening, everybody, and welcome to the Earn Your Stripes podcast brought to you by Elite Sports New York. I'm your host, Christian Karapakis, with Emmanuel Berbari and Charlie Harch joining us. He also writes for Elite Sports New York, so he'll be joining this podcast. Hopefully bring some sanity to this episode. Emmanuel, how are you doing over there?
I'm doing great, Christian. It's frigid outside. I just did a baseball broadcast over at school, and it was uncomfortable to say the least, but I'm looking forward to the warmer weather, and that signifies baseball right around the corner. And I'm excited for Sunday, Yankees opening day, and I'm sure we'll have a few words about that.
And Charlie, how are you doing?
Doing great, man. I'm happy to be here, and I'm happy for Sunday. Can't wait.
It should be a national holiday. It's a crime that it's not. But baseball season's here. The first pitch of the Major League season will be from the Yankees out of the right hand of Chris Archer and probably to Brett Gardner. And Tanaka gets a start for the Yankees. But let's just, the three of us, we're going to cover pretty much what happened this week, which is pretty much shaping the 25-man roster. Emmanuel, I'll ask you first. We'll get into the shortstop fill-in for Didi. Ronald Torres is apparently going to be the starting shortstop. Are you on board with that? Are you on the Torres bandwagon? What do you think of Torres being named the opening day starter at shortstop?
I'm completely on board, Christian. As you know, last podcast we were saying how the Yankees needed to go with the safe option, the not glamorous option for once, the one that fans weren't necessarily completely comfortable with it. Me and you, we're comfortable with it because we know that Ronald Torres was by far and away the best option for the New York Yankees here. He's filling the gap. He's been a more than serviceable utility man for them, and I don't think there was really any other way to go. You're not going to go with Ruben Tejada because he's just not there. He's not what you want. Torres is a far better option than Ruben Tejada. You're not going to go with Tyler Wade, who hasn't played a game in AAA yet. You're not going to go with Gleyber Torres, who has not played a game in AA yet. So I think the Yankees made the right decision here. He's a great defender, which plays into it. You're trying to not only replace Didi's bat, but his glove as well. And Torres has proven time and time again that he can get the job done at the dish as well. So I think the Yankees made the right decision here going with Ronald Torres. And that's basically my thought process on that. If there's anyone to replace him, it's him. And the Yankees went the right move there.
Yeah, it's really hard to argue with you. I was gunning for Torres too. And Charlie, we talked about, and Emmanuel, I talked to both of you about this. I think the whole Gleyber Torres craze and the whole let's start Tyler Wade, that was just a little bit crazy. And you both heard my opinions on that. I think it's just asinine. Charlie, I want to get your thoughts. Torres, I think honestly it's the ideal choice.
Yeah, it's the only choice. It's the boring choice, but it's the only choice. I mean, you look at the other options. Ruff Snyder was an option at one point, and that would not have worked out at all. You're talking about him and Starlin Castro?
Yeah.
That would not be too good, man. So while it's not an inspired choice by any means, it's definitely the safe choice. And he's not going to replace Didi. Nobody could, but he's definitely your best option.
Yeah, and I think that's crazy how people wanted people are thinking that. And I'm going to go back to the kids. I really rant about these people wanting these kids. People were expecting these kids to just come up and say, hey, you'll replace the production that Didi gave us. You'll do this. You'll be able to do that. That's crazy. Torres, we gave our case last week, Emmanuel and Charlie. We do a sports show every Thursday, so we talked about it too. It just makes sense. It fits. And let's talk about something that really didn't fit and really didn't make sense. Girardi had us thinking that Aaron Hicks almost had the starting right field job, and he obviously went the right choice in starting Judge. He named him the right fielder. I think it was earlier today he named him the starting right fielder. Emmanuel, it really didn't make sense to start Hicks, but Judge is the right fielder. Thoughts?
Hey, Aaron Hicks gave a really nice run for it. It shows that a good spring training can make an organization think twice about their course of action, and that's what the Yankees made us fans think for the past week, that Aaron Hicks actually might have an outside chance at winning the right field job, and that started with releasing a lineup just a couple days back that they said could, quote-unquote, could look like the opening day lineup, and it penciled in Hicks at the bottom of the order playing right field. So you got to give it to Aaron Hicks. Had a great spring training, coming off a great second half last year after the Yankees cleaned house. So he gave Judge a run for his money, but Judge didn't hurt himself either. Judge went for a 975 OPS in spring training, and if he can cut down on the strikeouts, if he can be more disciplined this year, if he can hit the major league breaking ball and play with the power that we all know he can, the Yankees aren't going to second-guess their choice to make him the starting right fielder. I don't think time at AAA would have done Judge any good at this stage in his development. He needs major league reps, and I think the Yankees won't come to regret that decision because they'll see what Judge can provide at the major league level, which is a middle-of-the-order bat that can go deep several times and hit for power in bunches.
It would have been a crime to not give Judge this starting right field job. He's in a time in both his career and development where it's time. It's time to go to the major league level. It's time to see what you can do. That's what 2017 is about with the Yankees. And there's really no debating it here. You send him to AAA, what does that do? Yeah, he's got to play either way. So, I mean, giving him every day at bats in AAA makes sense. But it really made no sense to start Hicks. From what we saw last year, yeah, he gave you some production when he got consistent playing time after Carlos Beltran was traded. But Judge is not one of those under-the-radar prospects that just started emerging. This is a guy the Yankees think will develop into a superstar. So Judge, no question about it. But here's one thing. Charlie, I'll ask you first. You mentioned Rev Snyder before. He sent right to AAA. Have the Yankees pretty much given up on Rob Rev Snyder?
You have to think so, right?
Yeah.
I mean, he's been here for, two full seasons now almost?
Yeah, he came up in 2015.
Yeah, and he's never been a starter. He's always been a utility guy. They just don't have the right fit for him. You know, I mean, he plays the outfield fine.
He's not the best glove.
Exactly.
In the,
so he doesn't really have a set position, and the Yankees really don't have a set team yet. They're still a rebuilding team, and he does not fit into their plans, it looks like.
Yeah, and man, I'll hop that. I'll go up right to you after that. Where do the Yankees go with Rob Rev Snyder now? So really, there's no spot for him. This was his pretty much last chance to earn a spot as a 25th roster guy. He lost that spot to Pete Cosma, who hasn't played since 2015 and who can't really hit a .150. So where do you see the Yankees going with Rob Rev Snyder now?
I'm shocked the Yankees haven't traded this guy yet.
Yeah.
You look at where he was in 2015, highly regarded as one of the top prospects in the Yankee system, one of the guys the Yankees were the most high on, and now he's at a point where there's just no place to put him. There's no use for him up in the bigs, and as you mentioned, that's why he lost his job to Pete Cosma. I'm surprised the Yankees haven't traded this guy yet. I'd be surprised if they don't go that route or do something of that nature. The question is, what is this guy's value now? Because all major league teams see now is a guy who just can't quite make it. He's gotten to the big leagues. He's contributed marginally, and he's shown he can hold his own at the big league level. But is a utility guy who doesn't have much of a glove and will hit you maybe 270, 275 with not much pop. So I'm not sure what other major league clubs see in that. But if the Yankees don't trade him, I'd be shocked because I don't know what he's doing for the Yankees down in AAA, what value he's serving the organization. I'd say it's just as obvious that the Yankees will trade this guy or get rid of him as the Aaron Judge move was. And back to the Judge point, I just wanted to make one more follow-up comment on it. I think the Judge move was just as obvious as the Greg Bird move. It's like Chris Carter tearing the cover off the ball in spring training and the Yankees saying, Greg Bird needs every day at bats at AAA. Aaron Hicks tearing the cover off the ball in spring training, the Yankees saying, Aaron Judge needs every day at bats at AAA. It just doesn't make any sense. You got to play these kids. They need the major league reps. And back to Rev Snyder, I'd say it's just as obvious that the Yankees need to do something with him via trade as it was to give Judge and Bird starting roles.
That's a good point you make about comparing it to Carter and Bird. Here's what I think Girardi did. Here, and yeah, everyone wants to say he has a man crush on Hicks, or Hicks has some embarrassing photos of him or Cashman, one or the other. Here's what I think really happened. Girardi wanted to light a fire under one or the other, whether it was Hicks for performing bad last year in the role where he pretty much plays against lefties when, and in place of Gardner and Ellsbury, didn't do well in that role. Maybe, and I'm hoping this is the case, that Girardi just used, oh, it's too close to call, as the kind of like, hey, let's get these guys going. Let's get Judge's strikeouts down. Let's do this, that, and the other thing. Because the three of us will all agree that it didn't make much sense for them to go Hicks at all. Charlie, what do you think?
Listen, we got to – Judge earned this. He really earned this over the spring training just because Hicks played well. Like Emmanuel said, Judge needs these reps, all right? He's a guy who needs to develop. He needs to get that strikeout percentage down. So I'm so happy that Girardi replaced Hicks with Judge in this lineup.
Yeah, it just – we want to know why Hicks, I think I like Hicks more than most. I know, Manuel, you do too. Charlie, I'm not sure if you like Hicks more than most, but
as a fourth outfielder, I love him. Yeah.
So he's not getting enough. I wouldn't say he's not getting love because he doesn't deserve love, but he's getting way too much hate right now. So I don't want to knock Hicks, but he's really not a starting outfielder. So Judge, ideal choice. Let's hop over to the pitching. And Emmanuel, you and I butted heads with this, with Severino. He got the fourth spot. First of all, before we go into it, do you want to tell me that you told me so?
It's not worth it. I thought this was obvious from the get-go. Luis Severino, how highly regarded he is within the organization. And Christian, I will admit, you made some good points the last time we had a podcast. Severino has not proven anything with his fastball command. That's worrisome. He may get crushed by big league hitters, but we all know how highly regarded he is by this Yankees organization, and that's what made it so obvious that, barring a detrimental setback and a horrific spring training from Severino that basically pitched him out of the fourth spot in this rotation, that he was getting the fourth spot in this rotation because the Yankees felt they owed it to themselves to try and see the ceiling of this kid one more time that we saw in 2015. If he gives it, that's a huge X factor for the Yankees this year. You may not think he will do it. I'm not even sure if I believe in myself that he's going to do it. But the Yankees owe it to themselves to see this kid try and perform at the level that he did in 2015. He earns the fourth spot, and he did earn it in spring training, had a pretty good spring. And we'll see how it unfolds. But I think it was obvious from the get-go that unless Severino pitched himself out of this role, that he was going to be slated as a fourth starter.
Yeah, and I don't understand. You know as well as I do, and Charlie, you do too, I've been talking about this kid for a while in Jordan Montgomery. Okay, for the record, Charlie doesn't like when I use the word kid because Montgomery is 4 years older than me. So there's one thing, but you both know how high I am on Jordan Montgomery. But I'm willing to sit back and say, yeah, we all knew that Severino would get the spot if he didn't, even if he just stayed with the pack and didn't separate. If he didn't separate in a negative direction, you kind of knew he was going to get the spot. So I'm not outraged that Montgomery didn't get it. He has a shot to earn it at AAA, and he could possibly be in the starting rotation by April 16th. But, Emmanuel, you said Luis Severino may struggle. I am very firm on the belief that he will struggle, and he won't make it through the first 2 months of the season with a starting rotation job in the major leagues. I talk about a lot how his changeup came. You saw right first game at spring training. I wrote a column about it. His changeup looked great. Pedro Martinez did him great. His changeup looked fantastic. Fastball command, I can't say the same thing. Even today, he settled down after a start against the Philadelphia Phillies, but that fastball was up for a majority of the game and even got knocked around in the first inning. And there was evidence that the fastball command isn't there because he walked the first batter he faced up 9 runs. How do you walk the... Okay, no, you don't do that. Anyway, so yeah, I don't think Luis Severino made any strides with his fastball to really make me optimistic at all, and I'm broken record saying this, but Luis Severino is going to struggle this season because he's going to do the same thing he did and not make any adjustments, go down to AAA. Emmanuel, we talked about the cycle in the first podcast. He's going to go down to AAA, get fastball happy, blow fastballs with guy people because those AAA hitters aren't good enough to hit those fastballs. Then he's going to come back to the majors, struggle again, go back to AAA, blah, 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 same thing. No strides made this spring. Wasn't great, wasn't bad. There you go. But that's spring training. He pitched a lot in the seventh inning, faced a lot of minor league guys. Charlie, where do you see Luis Severino? How do you see him performing in the first couple of weeks of the season?
Well, not great. However, the Yankees are in a position where they can throw him out and there are no consequences. This is not a team that's trying to win a World Series right now. Or, well, I could say they're trying to make the playoffs right now at best, but they're not trying to win the World Series. This is a team that's supposed to be rebuilding and evaluating talent. So they got to see what they have in Severino this year as a starter. He's probably going to end up a bullpen guy. However, you got to see what he has as a starter this year. This is the year they have to evaluate talent and see what they have in him.
And okay, Matt, I'll ask you this question going off that comment. I'll pretty much just recycle that right to you. What if Severino struggles, guys? What if he gets bombed in the major leagues? Then what do? You got to send him to AAA, right?
You think so, but we talked about that cycle, and I think the Yankees have seen it enough even last year that I think it would be asinine to send him back to AAA if he gets absolutely demolished the first couple of weeks. I think if he gets absolutely demolished the first couple of weeks, if I'm Brian Cashman and Joe Girardi, I don't even think about sending him back to AAA. I send him straight to the bullpen and let him flourish as a sixth or seventh inning man that everyone knows he can be. He can blow guys away in the bullpen. He can become a two-pitch pitcher. He can be what he wants to be, but can't be as a starter. So I don't even think twice about sending him back to AAA because we all know what's going to happen. He's going to get fastball happy. He's going to blow away subpar AAA hitters. He's going to work his way back to the major leagues, not based on fastball command, but based on numbers. And then those numbers are quickly going to diminish at the big league level. So if he struggles in the first month, which is a very big possibility, although I hope it doesn't happen for the Yankees' sake, if he struggles in the first month, I send him straight to the bullpen. I don't think about Scranton.
Yeah, for the record, we're not saying we hope Luis Severino struggles. I'm saying I think it's going to happen, and it very well might happen. But, Manuel, you're telling me this kid who's so highly touted and who was just a year ago called the ace, the future ace of the Yankees, you're saying at 23 years old, if he doesn't pan out within the next few weeks, bullpen guy?
Yes, because then it's obvious that the fastball command will never come. Mm. He's had this window to work on the fastball command. He had all of last year to work on it. He had all of spring to work on it and implement his third pitch, the changeup, which has looked pretty good for the record, and become more finesse as a starting pitcher. He's had the time. You can't say he hasn't had the time because he came up as a 21-year-old. So he's had the time to work on the stuff that can make him at least a middle-of-the-road major league starting pitcher. And he hasn't even gotten there. He's not even qualified to be a number four until he proves he's qualified to be a number four. So if he cannot do that, if he cannot make those strides, if he cannot become somewhat dominant again, I think the Yankees throw in the towel on this guy as a starter and make him a sixth or seventh inning man for this year that can really pitch the lights out. Because we saw what he did in the bullpen last year with a 0.39 ERA in 11 appearances. So I think he's as valuable to the Yankees as a sixth or seventh inning guy as he would be as a starter, probably a lot more considering if he struggles, he'll probably be pitching to the tune of an 80 ERA and allowing three home runs to start.
Manuel, I love you. We're good friends. I sound like Stephen A. Smith right now. Yeah. Whatever. Dude, this kid's 23 years of age. Fastball command is a very, very common problem with kids this young. But if you're going to throw the towel on him this early, you say he's just as valuable, if not more, in a middle relief or setup spot or as a reliever. You're basing that off of a small sample size. And yes, he was successful, but we've seen just as much success. His win probability added as a starter when he was successful in 2015 was like 5 points higher. I think it's three to five points. I don't have the numbers in front of me, but it was almost five points higher than it was as a starter than it was as a reliever. There is no way the Yankees can afford to throw him in the bullpen right now. If you're me, if I'm Joe Girardi, I keep the cycle going. I don't want to call it a cycle. I want to fix this problem I don't want to.
Why?
What do you mean, why?
We just went on a podcast last week ranting about this cycle and how it's going to keep going back and forth, back and forth, and how this guy won't.
That's on the coaching, though.
His fastball command. If he's not going to improve the fastball command, what value is he serving to you?
But that's
another 2 years going back and forth between AAA and the majors, trying to become a starter that he can't be. You may as well throw him into the bullpen and get some value out of him.
But you're going to get way more valuable. You have me mumbling over here. You will find so much more value in Luis Severino as a starting pitcher than you will as a bullpen. Book it. That can't really be disputed. If you have an ace, I'd rather have an ace than a middle reliever to set up man who can be dominant, especially when I have Aroldis Chapman and Dylan Betances. I'd much rather have Luis Severino pan out as an ace. But we talked about the cycle. Who is that on? You cannot blame a starting pitcher or a young kid. I'm not even a starting pitcher. You can't blame a young 23-year-old. He was 22 last year when he went down. So you can't blame a young guy in their young 20s, early 20s, to get fastball happy. You can't blame that. That's on the coaching. And the coaching has to get better and figure out how to fix this. You can't just say, okay, hands off, throw him in the bullpen, get done. You have to let him develop. The Yankees cannot afford another failed starter. Charlie, Matt and I are at each other's throats. What do you think of Luis Severino? If he struggles here, is it time to throw the towel in and say, bullpen guy?
Listen, we saw what he could do his first year in the Bronx. He was very, very, very high in potential. He had a bad year last year. He's still 23 years old. He's still 23. He's very young. We have to let him develop. I completely agree with you, Christian.
Boom! 2-1, Emmanuel. But anyway, listen.
Well, I'm not saying I don't want him to pan out as a starter. I'm saying.
Oh yeah. I know you're not trying to say
that.
There's
a fine line here of when you make that move to make him a bullpen guy. If you remember, I'm the advocate for having him in the rotation because I believe this guy can be dominant as a starter, and I want to see him pan out as a starter, and I think he can pan out as a starter. But if that cycle is going to continue, I think there's a very fine line here where the Yankees, it's going to be a tough decision what they keep doing, because if that player development isn't there at AAA, that's going to gain him that fastball command. When is it ever going to come? So I want him to pan out as a starter just as much as you guys do. But will it happen? That's a question we're going to have to see in April.
And this is another thing. I want to make it clear. The three of us want to see Luis Severino pan out as a starter. I'm not bashing Emmanuel and saying he doesn't want to see that. I know Emmanuel wants to see Luis Severino pan out as a starter. And I think the majority of the Yankee fan base will tell you the same thing. My issue with this is making him a bullpen guy this early is just way too premature. I mean, there's a reason why we called him the future ace. There's a reason why he was so highly touted. I think if you throw in the towel right now, you're giving up way too early, especially when we're so fresh off seeing him dominate just a year ago, 2015. So we all saw what he's capable of. There's a reason why he's highly touted. I mean, I understand the cycle, and Mal, you convinced me that the cycle is real, because it is real. But I think you're really in a tough situation with Luis Severino right now, and I don't think the Yankees are in a position where they'll hinder the development and the potential for Luis Severino to reach that ceiling for a successful stint in the bullpen in 2017, a year which they really shouldn't be competing.
It's interesting. I agree with what you're saying, Christian. You want to develop the guy. I just don't know how much longer you can wait for non-existent fastball command to come. And I don't know when that benchmark is there. I don't know if it comes at 24 years old, 25 years old. I guess it differs for every pitcher. But Luis Severino, you have to value what's more important with him, what's more important for the team. What's his ceiling as a major league pitcher? Is his ceiling a dominant starter? Is his ceiling a serviceable back of the rotation guy? Is his ceiling maybe a Dylan Betances caliber reliever? I know that's a stretch, but I'm saying that type of dominance in the back end of the bullpen. You have to determine what that ceiling is, and that ceiling is basically going to be determined by how good Luis Severino is as a starter within the first month of 2017, whether that cycle begins again or whether Severino is going to make 15, 20 starts at the big league level this year or more and be a staple in the rotation and potentially aid a shaky rotation into becoming a more formidable one.
Yeah, we all hope Severino is going to pan out. He'll get the chance to do so. So that's the bottom line. He's the fourth spot. Let's get our early prediction. So basically, let's make an early prediction on the fifth spot, Emmanuel. So for those who don't know, Chad Green is going to AA. Jordan Montgomery is going to AAA. So I think all three of us can safely assume that those two guys are in the running to get the fifth spot. So both of them will start for their respective levels on April 6th and April 11th and be ready to pitch by April 16th. Charlie, if you had to go with a prediction right now, Jordan Montgomery or Chad Green?
I'll be honest, I'm still a Brian Mitchell guy. I really think he should be the fifth starter, but Montgomery, really, he outplayed Green in spring training, I think. I think he should be the fourth starter.
Yeah, there's an argument there. I mean, I know what the Yankees are thinking going by Luis Severino, and I'm totally behind putting Luis Severino there, but yeah, I really like Montgomery.
Yeah, I think Montgomery is they're going to the five-starter rotation when?
April 16th.
Okay. And he's going to have one start by then.
Two starts. Both him and Green will have two starts.
Okay. Yeah, but I definitely got Montgomery.
Yeah. You both of you know that I'm with the Montgomery bandwagon. I don't think Chad Green has – I don't think he has a career ahead of him as a major league starter. I mean, I love Green. I was at the game when he dominated the Toronto Blue Jays. I like what I saw. But I don't think his stuff has major league starter written on it. I'm all high on Montgomery. Now, Manuel, I know you were high on Brian Mitchell, but do you think the fifth battle has come down to Green versus Montgomery, or is Mitchell kind of in the mix?
I agree with Charlie in the fact that I thought Mitchell maybe even earned himself the fourth spot in spring. I don't think he pitched himself out of a role at all, but I think the fact that the Yankees are going with him right out of the gates in the bullpen shows where they're leaning with this. I don't think Mitchell is still in the running for a fifth spot, and I think it's going to come down between Green and Montgomery, especially the way they've aligned it with the two starts on the exact same days at two different levels, lining them up for the April 16th start, either one. Right now, I'm leaning Montgomery. I agree with you along the lines, Christian, of Chad Green. I'm not sure if I really see a career for him as a major league starter at this point. I think he could become a dominant reliever, a valuable reliever for the Yankees at some point at the big league level if that's where he's headed. But Jordan Montgomery, I don't see any signs indicating that he won't have a successful first two starts. I think what's going to happen is he'll have a good first two starts, impress the Yankees at AAA, as he did near the end of last year, get the promotion, pitch on April 16th, and then Chad Green will get bumped up to AAA, where he'll start every 5 days until the Yankees have a need in that bullpen for him to come up and contribute.
Yeah, here's like my only issue with how the starting rotation is lining out. Brian Mitchell in the bullpen, because I know because it makes you seem like Green outpitched Brian Mitchell, which I don't really think was the case. Green looked great. He didn't start a lot. He came out in the pen a lot in the sixth, seventh inning and faced a lot of AAA minor league guys. So that's why I think Green's ERA was so low and Brian Mitchell got a lot of starts and a good start. I think Mitchell caved under the pressure of, hey, I got to step up my performance. He maybe overplayed himself. I don't know. But my concern is I see Mitchell as a starter more than I see Chad Green as a starter. I'm more comfortable with Green in the pen than I am with Brian Mitchell in the pen, only because I see Green as an Adam Warren 2.0. I see him being that swing man, long relief guy. Brian Mitchell, he has starter written all over him.
It's interesting, and you never know how things are going to pan out. This is definitely where the Yankees are leaning, and it may not feel right for us. It's definitely where they're leaning, and that's why they have Mitchell in the bullpen to start. But if someone underperforms, Brian Mitchell's right in there. If someone gets hurt, Brian Mitchell's right in there. And we all know the question marks that are 1 through 5 in the Yankee rotation, not just in the back end of the rotation. So if someone gets hurt, Mitchell slides in there. Someone underperforms, Mitchell slides in there, makes a couple good starts, he'll probably be a mainstay. So I don't think this Mitchell starting experiment is too far-fetched and basically over here. And I don't think the Yankees view him as a reliever. I just think as of right now, for one reason or another, they're siding with Montgomery or Green as the number five starter. But I think Mitchell will eventually find his way in that rotation, and he'll shed some light on the fact that, look, this guy is starting material. What is he doing out there in the bullpen in a role he probably shouldn't be in?
Yeah, you hit the nail on the head on that. And let's use that to segue into the status of the starting rotation, because this is a Yankees preview show, by the way, guys. So let's look at the starting rotation, the status of the rotation. Question marks everywhere. Charlie, I'll go to you first. Where do you see this rotation? How do you see it panning out throughout the 2017 season?
Yeah, not great. You have Tanaka, who's obviously you're going to get great numbers from Tanaka.
Hopefully.
But the 4-5 spot, man, it's rough. And, of course, Pineda, you got all the potential there, but he never pans out. CeCe, we talked about on our other show. We don't know if he's going to stay healthy. He's 37, 38 now. He reinvented himself last season. Not a overpowering pitcher anymore, more of a precision pitcher. I don't think he stays healthy anymore. So this rotation is going to be a huge question mark, as you said. That's going to be why this team does not make the playoffs this year.
Yeah. We both said the age wrong, by the way, on our other show. It's 36.
36.
I think I said 39 in the other show. I don't know where that came from. Whatever. But I'm so professional, it's not even funny, guys. But, okay, Manuel, we talked about this before, and I know you wrote a column about this. Okay, so where do you see the rotation going? Do you see it? We talked about, we'll get to it later with our true and false segment that I really want to do. Where, compared to last year, where do you see this really panning out for the rotation, as the rotation concerns?
I think this rotation can be a little bit better. I'm just going to take the glass half full mentality, because I think maybe you have one standout performer that you didn't necessarily expect to be a standout performer, and then all of a sudden you're a notch ahead of last year. Because I think although Michael Pineda has been a liability, and he is a guy that has been an enigma, a mystery for that matter, he was pretty awful last year. And he had some flashes of brilliance, but overall he was pretty awful. He had an awful start that nearly got him demoted, to the fact that now you look at his 2016 totals, and they look pretty atrocious. There's no cutting that under the rug. Pineda can have a much better year this year, and I think that overall improves the numbers of the staff. I think Tanaka, in a walk year, in a contract year, trying to get paid after this year, whether it's with the Yankees or elsewhere, he's going to cash in big time. He has a lot to prove coming off a really, really tremendous season. Pitching, anchoring the Yankee staff, and that partially torn UCL, although it remains a question mark, it's kind of a question mark that's subsided, because Tanaka's proven he's one of the more dominant pitchers in baseball. So I think Tanaka has a great year, maybe even better than last year. That improves the staff.
And
you're looking for maybe one more guy to exceed expectations. Is that Severino? Who knows? I think Sabathia's kind of redefined himself, and you know what to expect. I would expect around a 500 record from Sabathia, like last year. Maybe the ERA goes up a tick, but you know what he's going to give you. You know he's not that overpowering Sabathia that you're getting. So Sabathia stays the same. A few things go in the north direction that you would expect to go in the north direction. This rotation is slightly better. Is it a playoff rotation? Is it a top-tier rotation? Not close to it, but a little bit better than last year. I think they can achieve that.
Okay, so last year the Yankees rotation ranked 19th in ERA, 16th in overall WAR. That's the middle of the pack. That's average. They were an average rotation last year. So a tick better than last year would mean they're still around average, maybe a little above average.
Yeah.
So I just don't see it. And I'm way on the left here. You're going glass half full. I'm going glass is on the ground, broken and shattered into 5,000 pieces. You're banking on Tanaka to have an even better year than last year, which was great, a great year. He should have been a little higher considered in the Cy Young voting, considering that Rick Porcello actually won it. So Tanaka had a Cy Young caliber season last year. Pineda made us all look at the stat sheet. We saw the K per nine and then the ERA and the home runs were like, what? So Pineda is nothing more than an enigma. We use the word so much because that's what he is. He's an enigma. So you're banking on Tanaka, who still has the partially torn UCL. I will never play that down. You have Pineda, who's proven over the last 5 years he can either A, not stay healthy, or B, be on one side of the spectrum. He can't stay consistent. Then you have CeCe Sabathia, who's coming off three seasons, which he was downright terrible, had a reinvention season, his best year since 2012. So you're banking on that to happen again after three of the last 4 years it didn't happen. Odds are not in your favor. And then you're asking Luis Severino, who, let's go back to 5 minutes ago. His command has looked awful. I don't expect him to come out of the gate as a starter and dominate, although I want to see it. And then on April 16th, you're going to have Chad Green or Jordan Montgomery be asked to maintain or stabilize an otherwise shaky rotation, and that's putting it lightly. This rotation is awful, and it's going to hold this team back to the point where they're going to be playing with 80 to 85 wins, and that's the only reason why I'm so down on this team and not really high on it is because of the rotation. And I scrapped the true and false question for later. The question later was going to be, will this rotation be better than last year? And I do not see it because I'm banking on so much went right last year to make the team finish in the middle of the pack. You have to have all that go right and some to push this team above where it was last year. But
go ahead. You make some good points. You make some good points with the rotation. The one thing in which I disagree, you mentioned Sabathia's three prior years, prior to last year. He did not even remotely attempt to reinvent himself during those 3 years prior. He didn't have the cutter. He wasn't locating. Also, you can take into other factors of the health. He was healthy last year, wasn't healthy for 3 years prior. He was dealing with a horrific alcoholism disease the 3 years prior, wasn't dealing with that last year. So there are plenty of factors of Sabathia that have subsided, that have improved, and now Sabathia has redefined himself as a pitcher. He has an identity as a pitcher. So if you're looking at him to stay around the same numbers, I don't think it's far-fetched at all, especially at this stage of his career. Not trying to overpower people. He loves this style of pitching. He's taken after Andy Pettit. So if there's one thing in which I disagree when you ran down the rotation, it's the Sabathia part. But the other parts, yes, this is why this is nothing more than a mediocre rotation. The reason I think even if the rotation improves, they'll still finish 80 to 85 wins is because I think the lineup's going to have growing pains. Yeah, you have guys like Sanchez, Judge, Bird, all playing their first full big league seasons. There are going to be ups and downs. So this lineup may not be as dynamic as you think at some point in the season. There are growing pains. There are ups and downs. You couple that with the rotation, that might be slightly better, might have some ups and downs itself. You're looking at 80 to 85 wins. So regardless of this rotation taking a step up, there are other factors that can go wrong as well.
Yeah, and Charlie, I'll ask you about CeCe, but my thing is CeCe, I love CeCe. I know what he did last year. The cutter came into the mix, but the thing is, I don't think that, because last year was a great year. For Sabathia and his stage of the game, the pitcher he was, the pitcher he is now, great season. No one's debating that. My debate is, will he do it 2 years in a row? I just don't think that's the case.
I don't think he... Here's the thing. He's 36.
We got the age. The age is 36.
Right. At a certain point, you break down. Listen, he's not in the best shape. So,
And there's the health concern with me. The fact he's not in the best shape.
And you had that knee injury, or was it ankle?
Knee. Knee.
So you had that. I understand that he's moved from a power pitcher to a guy who's all about precision. But at some point, man, you just hit that age and you can't perform anymore, and I'm afraid it's going to be this year.
Yeah, and it very well might be, because, again, we saw one out of the last 4 years, and I know, Emmanuel, you mentioned that he really didn't reinvent himself in the first 3 years, but the health concerns were there those 3 years. He missed some time with the knee, and my thing is I'm banking on health and production to do it again 2 years in a row, and it's just really hard for me to buy into that.
The one thing with Sabathia about last year that you can take as a negative is the fact that he had that one stretch where he won seven straight starts, pitched to an ERA sub-3. It was a ridiculous stretch that really inflated his numbers come season end. I'm not sure if that's going to be the case this year. He might pitch more steady the entire way through. But if there's one negative to take about Sabathia, it's the fact that he had that one outlandish stretch last year that you wouldn't expect to happen at any point this year, where he completely turned back the clock and was even an all-star consideration at one point.
Yeah, again, I'm a huge CeCe guy. When he was going through the alcohol problem, I was writing so much things about, so many positive things. When people were giving up on him heading into last year, I said, hey, this is a guy who's really going to reinvent himself. He's coming off a lot of adversity in this over the last few years, ever since 2012. So, great guy, really rooting for him. again, not ready to buy into it. Let's go to something that I think will help. I don't know if it'll help, but it might be able to equalize out the rotation. The lineup looks a lot better than last year. Charlie, I'll go to you first, then I'll go to Emmanuel. How optimistic are you of this pretty much a new-look lineup?
Yeah, so Emmanuel said earlier that they're going to be growing pains, and he's right. These are all pretty much first-year guys, I would say, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so the only concern I have is the sophomore slump.
Yeah.
And there are going to be a lot of growing pains. You're counting on pretty much the three to six holes.
Well, now with Gary Sanchez, the two holes, so it's like
right,
two to four.
Right, but eventually, when Didi comes back.
Yeah.
So those guys are going to struggle for a long period of the season, I fear.
So you're talking about the Greg Bird, the Gary Sanchez,
yes,
the Judge?
And especially Judge. Judge I'm very concerned about.
Okay.
I think he's going to cut his strikeout rate a ton.
Well, it's 50%. He better.
Yeah. But he's not going to... Very staticky.
Hey, we're good.
Okay. I feel like he's going to bat a decent average. Strikeout rate going to fly down. However, he's still going to have a long period where he struggles, dude.
Yeah, and that's the main concern, Emmanuel. So growing pains is going to be a concern, and that's what I think a lot of Yankees fans really aren't considering. They're going to be growing pains. Everyone's so high on the baby bombers. But overall look of the lineup, where do you see it? Are you optimistic? Are you pessimistic? Are you cautiously optimistic? What are you seeing?
I'm optimistic about this lineup compared to last year because of what I saw the final 2 months. I think the Didi Gregorius loss for the first month and a half really hurts. I think he deepens this lineup tremendously, and he's a huge part to this lineup. Without him, I think the lineup takes a little bit of a step back. But regardless, I like this lineup. But again, the growing pains, people keep pointing at the starting rotation. And yes, you can point at the starting rotation all you want, but there will be problems with this lineup at times as well. You have guys in Greg Bird, Aaron Judge, Gary Sanchez playing their first full big league season in the show. And you're looking at a guy like Gary Sanchez. He not only needs to play a full big league season, which he's never done, but he needs to do it behind the plate for a full season, which we all know take its burden on a young catcher. So these guys are going to have their ups and downs. You got to expect that. You can't expect Bird, Sanchez, Judge to be flawless for an entire 162-game span. It's just naive to think that. So I do think the lineup takes a step up, a huge step up from last year, especially the first half of last year. I'm very excited about what they potentially can do. They're going to be an exciting team to watch, a lot more exciting than the first half of last year, to say the least, and similar to the second half of last year. But you do have to expect those growing pains, and you have to be cautiously optimistic, in a sense, about this lineup just because of those growing pains.
Yeah, and you use my favorite word. It's pretty much my word of the month. It's naive, because that's what a lot of people are falling into. People are thinking that Gary Sanchez is going to hit 68 home runs, think Greg Bird is going to continue his 38 homer pace. It's really not going to happen. But, again, a lot of righty pop. I like the athleticism in this lineup. These aren't big-footed lefty hitters hitting into the teeth of the shift. These are right-handed bats with some pop. And a lot of signs I've seen in the spring training that has me optimistic. Judge is being more aggressive, avoiding the pitcher-friendly counts. He already struggles with pitch recognition, but he's cut down on watching first-pitch strikes. He's cutting down on letting the curveball get him, let pitchers set themselves up. He's done a great job. Gary Sanchez, here's something that I want to run by both of you. I am way more looking forward to seeing what Gary Sanchez can do over a full season behind the plate that I am at the plate. What do you guys think? Because he's got a cannon. Charlie, go to you first.
Yeah, man. He was gunning down guys in spring training all spring training long, man. I don't agree with you that I'd rather see him catch than bat at the plate. I think
that was a little bit of a stretch.
Yeah, it's a bit of a stretch, but I'm really looking forward to watching Gary play this year.
Manuel, what do you think of my hot take? Give me more Gary behind than at the plate.
I think if you're looking from a developmental standpoint, I completely agree with you. You got to see how he is behind the plate. Also, you got to see how he handles his pitching staff for a complete 162-game season. It's not easy. It's not easy to keep these pitchers in line. It's not easy to weather the storm in big games. It's not easy to take a trip to the mound when you're supposed to take a trip to the mound. Not a lot of catchers know how to handle big situations on big stages. We'll see how he can do that, and especially with a questionable starting rotation. a lot of that burden is going to be left on his shoulders to handle that starting staff, groom that starting staff, and help them through ball games. And he's a young kid, so we'll see what he can do in that matter. He has a cannon that's going to be very exciting to watch, but I'm more looking for, as far as a developmental standpoint, how he handles his pitching staff and how he can call a game and manage a game.
Yeah, and that's the thing. Going back to the lineup now, that's the thing about Gary Sanchez with me. I'm looking at Gary Sanchez. This is a full season of him at the catcher position. That's the most grueling position in baseball. Hopefully the Yankees give him – I think the Yankees will. They'll give him a sufficient amount of DH days. So that's good. But, yeah, with this lineup, again, I see Brett Gardner at the top getting on base, doing his thing. I see Gary Sanchez in the number two hole, seeing a lot of good pitches in front of Greg Bird, because if you're a pitcher, I don't want to pitch around Gary Sanchez, so I'm going to pitch at him because I don't want to pitch around Greg Bird. So then it's Greg Bird and Gary Sanchez seeing good pitches. A lot of protection behind both of them in Matt Holliday and Aaron Judge. Didi comes back, Starlin Castro. A lot to love about this lineup. And, yeah, a lot better than last year. Oh, my goodness. Last year was tough to watch with runners in scoring position. The pop was gone. There was nothing. The lineup was dead. So a lot to love. I think that if the rotation, although I don't think it's going to happen, if they somehow get to the production they were at last year, we can see a surprise team here. Because, again, the rotation held its own last year. So, yeah, we've been bashing the Yankees, and I think if you don't know anything about the Yankees and you're listening to us for the first time, you think this team's about to lose 100 games. But really, if you think about it, if this rotation stays where they were at last year, which is the middle of the pack, the bullpen looks a lot better, so the back-end tandem, middle relief looks good. Lineup should be a lot better. Guys, are we sleeping on the Yankees? Charlie, you first. Are we sleeping on this Yankees team?
I think so, and you didn't even mention Matt Holliday, who's going to have a huge impact on this team.
About Matt Holliday, both at the dish and off the field in the clubhouse. We're talking about a former batting champion teaching the next group of Yankee superstars. So, yeah. Matt Holliday is going to be huge.
Going to be an absolutely huge addition. And personally, I'm not too high on the Yankees. I have them. So I originally predicted them to win the second wild card. Mm-hmm. I'm rethinking that.
You just did this a half hour ago.
I know, yeah. That pitching staff has a lot of questions, and the more I think about it, I do not think the offense can carry them. I just simply think the pitching has too many question marks.
Manuel, are we sleeping on the Yankees?
I don't think we're sleeping on them at all. I think we're in a very good spot right now, predicting them to win around 85 games. You know, we're looking at that 84 to 86 game window. I think if you don't have a guy like Matt Holliday, a guy like Chris Carter in there, veteran presences who know how to weather the storm, have been through the grind, the dog days, the wear and tear of an 162-game schedule, they know how to mentor these young guys, teach them the right way to go about their business. This might be the Yankees' first losing season in forever.
Oof.
But with these guys, that's what pushes them over the edge. That's what gets them those 84 85 wins, maybe 86 wins, and closer to a wild card. So I don't think anyone's sleeping on the Yankees right now. I think all these mid-80s predictions are right around where they will be, where they've been the last few years, where they'll continue to be until these guys emerge and they make that next big move to propel them to becoming a champion.
All right, so do you have an exact number? Because I'm going 86 wins.
I'm going to go 85. Okay. I was thinking about it the last couple days. I was thinking about going 87, which would be enough for a second wild card. I'm going 85. I'm not sure what the second wild card will be this year because it's going to vary with the American League and the National League. There have been times where a second wild card is 185. There have been times where it's taken 89 wins to get a second wild card. It depends on the strength of the American League, particularly the American League West, in my opinion, with the Texas Rangers, the Houston Astros, who could be a surprise this year, and the Seattle Mariners, who have some good pitching, and Cano and Cruz in the middle of the lineup. It all depends on that American League West. I'm going 85 for the Yankees. I think it's completely reasonable to predict that from them. And then the rest of the American League will determine whether they're really in it come September.
Charlie, you got an exact win?
I'm right there with Emmanuel. I got them at about 84, 85 wins.
Yeah, I'm at 86. But here's some room for optimism, guys. It'll put us all to shame. With the win today over Philadelphia in their last Grapefruit League spring training game, the Yankees matched their modern record for spring wins set in what year? 2000? 2009. Manuel.
Ooh.
Hey, are we? Yeah. So this is it. But
fond memories.
A lot of fun memories. 2009. I think that's really, for the three of us, it's really the only World Series. I mean, I remember 2003, but we lost that year. Barely remember 01 and barely remember 2000. And after that, it's just a cloud because we're all really children. But so, yeah, I think I'm not expecting 2009 to happen. But another thing to go off of the spring training stats that I just gave you. Since 2011, five out of the six teams that finished with the best overall spring record did not make the playoffs. That's five out of six teams, and only two of those six teams finished above 500. So, yes, they set their modern record, but over the last 6 years, teams who finished with the best spring record really doesn't have enough luck. So here's the lesson is, spring training, throw it out the window. It's done. It has no authenticity. It's done. If you're basing off your predictions off spring training numbers, stop it. You're making a fool of yourself. Whatever. I'm glad spring training is over because of this. It really is frustrating to see.
Completely agreed. Nothing annoys me more than when they win a spring training game and the Yankee account does the hashtag start spreading the news. What news are we spreading? That the Yankees won a spring training game? That these fans are way too overexcited. If anything is learned from that stat, Christian, you're right. It's that you can never overvalue spring training wins. Can overvalue spring training performances in individual areas of people's games. As a team, it's worthless. The only thing that means something is this Sunday moving forward.
Yeah, that was a very good quote. That's going to go in our intro when we make that. Very good quote, Manuel. Appreciate that. Anyway, so so I was going to say something. Oh, true or false? Let's play this game. So, Charlie, you'll moderate, and Manuel and I will go at it.
Let's do it.
So, basically, there's the list of questions. Just read it off, and we'll say true or false.
Here you go. True or false, Gary Sanchez will hit 35 home runs.
Manuel, go ahead.
Gary Sanchez goes under 35 home runs. I'm going false. I see him in the 27 to 31 range, which Yankee fans should be ecstatic with. This is a guy playing his first full year as a big league catcher. Any catcher who hits 27 to 31 home runs is extremely valuable in this league. 35, way too high for me.
Yeah, I'm going false. Charlie, we asked this question to each other in our Empire State College show. I'm going 20 to 25. And, yeah, the Yankees will take this because, again, last year their home run leader was Carlos Beltran and they traded him. So, yeah, I'm going 20, 25. Again, I'm really more looking forward to seeing what he can do behind the plate because, again, he had a cannon. Some of the hardest throws for a catcher he had last year in his brief 53 games.
I personally have him at 33 home runs this year, so it's a bit under. Next question, true or false, Greg Bird will have a better year than Tino Martinez did in 1996. Martinez had a batting average of .292, an OBP of .364, and a slugging percentage of .466 with 25 home runs and 117 RBIs.
Mm-hmm.
Absurd. Absurd. Not happening. That's Greg Bird's ceiling, and I think he can become that. This guy can be a batting champion. I could see him winning 3-4 batting titles down the road. This guy can hit the ball to all fields with authority. That's his ceiling. He can be a .292, 25, and 115 guy, and I'd love to see that down the road. That's absurd for this year. It's completely ludicrous. If Greg Bird goes for 20 and 80 this year, along with a .285 batting average, again, Yankee fans, you're falling out of your chair. Temper the expectations and keep it there. False.
You know I'm all about the bold predictions. I remember the Giants, I called them winning 11 games last year. I remember when the Yankees had that series, that first series in Comerica last year, I called an A-Rod home run. But yeah, I'm all in on the bold predictions, but not this one. This is crazy. A pretty much reason why, I see Greg Bird reaching this ceiling eventually. In fact, I see a lot of similarities. I see a lot of Tino Martinez in him. But he struck out in a third of his at-bats last year. Again, sit on the couch all of last season. .230 against left-handed pitching. Again, coming off a year where he just didn't do anything. Yeah, he looks good in spring training, but yeah, no thank you.
All right, next question. True or false, the Yankees will have their first losing season since 1992.
Manuel?
That is a false. for me. Once again, as I mentioned before, there's the potential of that if they didn't have some of those veteran pieces to weather the storm. And I also think they have a losing season if they don't have Joe Girardi there. We were chatting about this the other day, Christian, me and you. If Joe Girardi can take a team that has Lyle Overbay at first base, Jason Nixon shortstop, yeah, Kevin Youkilis at third base, Vernon Wells in right field, to 85 wins, he can take this team maybe even above 85 wins. Certainly not a losing season. I'm going false there.
Yeah, and here's the thing about 2017 Yankees that I'm – the reason why I asked you guys if you think people are sleeping on them is because this is a team last year that waved the white flag, got rid of two of the best relievers in baseball, finished the year on a 90-win pace without a serviceable first baseman, without Aaron Judge doing anything in right field, with a rotation, again, cluttered with question marks that constantly had guys rotating in and out. That team finished on a 90-win pace. Now you're throwing in Greg Bird back in there. You're throwing Matt Holliday, who should be a better DH than A-Rod was last year. So that's why I'm very optimistic about this team. No, false. They will not have their first losing season since 1992. No way, Jose. Next question.
Will we see 15 starts from Luis Severino this season?
Manuel?
I'm going true just because I've been on the Severino bandwagon. Christian, I can already sense the negative energy coming in my direction. But at this point, I'll say true. I want to see Severino succeed. Will he succeed? We'll see. I can see Severino putting together a season where he's not necessarily the frontline starter that the Yankees expected him to be and wanted him to be, not the ace they hoped he would evolve into. But at the very least, he can establish himself as a number four starter, as a starter in the major leagues. I'll go true for this one. I need to pick true on something. I'm going with this one. He's gonna make at least 25 starts.
False for me, and you knew I was going in that direction. Don't see Luis Severino succeeding. And, yeah, I mean, we talked about Luis Severino all in the beginning part of the show. I just think that his fastball command isn't there yet. I'm a broken record in saying that. Change up again. Had strides. Will it be good enough? Probably not. And I don't think he makes 15 starts. I think he's actually out of the rotation and in AAA by mid-June.
So I think you your answer is pretty obvious on this one. True or false, Severino will win Rookie of the Year?
Oh, it was Aaron Judge. That was supposed to be.
Okay,
I didn't fill it in. I'm sorry.
Definitely not Severino.
Yeah, right. No. So read the question again. I'll cut it out.
Yeah. True or false, Aaron Judge will win Rookie of the Year?
Manuel.
I go true because I think this guy's power goes without saying. Even if he hits 220, even if he strikes out 50% of his at-bats, if he hits 30 to 35 home runs, which both you and I believe, expect him to do over a full 162-game season, if he stays on the field, if he's healthy, he's the Rookie of the Year. The baseball writers will not pass up on a chance to give a guy like Aaron Judge, who hits above 30 home runs in his rookie season, the Rookie of the Year. So I'm going yes. That was one of my bold predictions that I picked on my radio show. So I'm not going to go against it. Aaron Judge is your American League Rookie of the Year. True.
There's some competition. You got the guy in Boston. What is it, Benintendi?
Benintendi.
Yeah, he looks good, too. He's got some competition. But like I said, I love what I've seen from Judge in spring training. Again, we talked about what you look for in spring training. And for me, it's not really the home runs he hit. It's not the OPS, which was still astronomical. It's the fact that he was more aggressive, and I like that. I hope he carries that into 2017. I like how he's not impressed either. He said, like, when somebody was asked about winning the right field job, he's like, yeah, it's okay, I'll do my job. So, yeah, I like the attitude, I like the aggressiveness. I like Aaron Judge to win the Rookie of the Year. I agree with you. True.
All right, and the last question. True or false, we will see the major league debut of James Kaprielian?
False. I don't think that happens this year. I don't see a pressing need. I think it would be a stretch even to say that he would be a September call-up. You're asking this guy to motor through the minor league system when he really hasn't at the pace that the Yankees would have liked. He's going to start the year in high A. Even if he gets his way to triple A, which I think would be ideal for the Yankees, and starts to pitch well there, I don't think he gets there in time to get that September call-up. I think he's a year away. It's nothing against James Kaprielian. I think he's going to be a good major league starter. And I also think he will go through the system rather quickly, as the Yankees hoped so. But I think it's a matter of not enough time this year. He comes up in 2018.
I am going true because I see this rotation falling on its back and not being productive. And I guarantee, I don't want to guarantee, but I have a feeling that one of these guys in the starting rotation now are going to go down with an injury. I don't think Luis Severino is going to be there. I think the constant Green, Montgomery, Mitchell, whoever it is, they're just going to be rotated out. That's counting off my fingers, that's three or four spots that will be vacant at some point. I think Kaprielian is a fast riser. I think the Yankees are very high on him. He's a very mature pitcher. Came off. The only reason why I'm very, I'm not so high on my true pick here is because the Yankees are probably going to put a pitch limit on him. But I could very well see him come up in September and come out in the bullpen, maybe for a couple games, just to see what he's got at the major league level, get his feet wet. But I see him making his debut in 2017. So, Charlie, go to you first. Anything else you want to add about these 2017 Yankees before we go?
Yeah, man, it's all about pitching. It is all about pitching. If they get production out of their 4 and 5 spot, we could have some winners. I just don't see that happening.
Manuel, you?
I agree with Charlie. All about the pitching. If the pitching performs, the Yankees are a surefire playoff team. But the pitching is going to be nothing more than mediocre again. We're making these predictions as to whether they'll be a little bit better or a little bit worse than last year, but that's not saying much. This pitching is not going to be great. It's going to be an exciting team to watch. But my final thought about the 2017 Yankees is not whether they're going to win 85 games, not whether they're going to make the playoffs. It's that regardless of if they win or lose, we're not going to be turning the game off in the fifth inning because it's a very exciting team to watch, and I think you haven't had that in the Bronx in a while, and I think that's what makes Baby Bombers and the 2017 Yankees so exciting.
Very, very, very well said, Emmanuel. My little two cents would probably be, yeah, this team is exciting. This team's athletic. This team is something else. I don't have to yawn, but again, watching Lyle Overbay field ground balls at first or watching Vernon Wells chug around the base path, this is a different team. This is the dawn of a new era. The 2017 Yankee season will begin Sunday. And that will do it for this edition of Earn Your Stripes podcast. Charlie, Emmanuel, have a good night.